I have been writing for just about as long as I can remember. I could already read and write when I went to kindergarten. And you know how in kindergarten you have choice time or free time? Whenever we had choice time or free time, I would always choose to write a story. So my kindergarten teacher worried about that. And actually, I remember also her once asking me, "Linda Sue, would you please choose to do something else today?" Because she was worried about this. So I have been writing as long as I can remember. I have to say that I think I probably took the library for granted, because my father had been taking me since before I could walk, probably. For him, as an immigrant from a country that had been through a couple of very devastating wars, where libraries were not a real high priority, the libraries in this country were a miracle. He just couldn't believe it. He was 19 years old when he went into his first public library ever. And if you think about it, it's a very bizarre concept. I can walk in and take whatever I want? Yeah, sure, just bring them back. You know, you can't do that with anything else. And it's really kind of an alien idea. All of my favorite books were, for me, exotic stories. I would include in that something like A Tree Grows in Brooklyn. I was a Midwestern suburban girl. You know, I lived in a small town near cornfields, and Brooklyn was exotic to me. You know, it was this big city which I had never lived in, and Francie Nolan lived in this tenement, which was a very different setting for me. And yet she loved the library and she loved to read. So finding something in common with people who lived in very different circumstances was by far the most rewarding thing for me. And I think that's what books can do for young people. They're a bridge. They're a way to get to know people who are very different and to say, but wait, in a lot of ways they are like me. It wasn't until I was grown and had children of my own that I realized, oh, there's probably just a treasure trove of stories in my own family that I've never looked into. Some young people may come to that much sooner than I did, and they may well be interested in grandma or grandpa, tell me about when you were young. How was it different in whatever country you lived in? And if that's the case, wonderful. Write them down. Oftentimes, it's grandma and grandpa or even your parents who can't write in English or can't speak in English and can't share those stories in the way that you can. You can help, even if it's only writing down a story or two of your grandparents that you then just show to the rest of your family. My daughter kept a swap journal, which I think is a wonderful idea. She would write something, and a letter, a poem, a little story, and this was when she was in third or fourth grade, and she would give the journal to her friend when she'd finished. And her friend would write something back, either a letter back, another poem, or something completely different. They didn't have to follow up on what the person before had written. And then she'd give it back to my daughter. And each time they'd keep the journal for 3 or 4 days. And they kept that journal going for the entire school year. So somebody else was reading what my daughter had written. And I think that for many people, that's another reason to write. It is an act of communication. You want someone else to read what you've written. I ask the young people to try to take writing and put it in the same compartment in their heads where sports and music lives. To say, oh, yeah, of course, in order to improve at writing, I'm going to have to repeat or write the same thing again and try to improve it each time. I ask them to try to take it for granted that writing belongs in that same kind of category, so that they don't say, oh, no, I have to rewrite this, but rather they say, oh, well, duh, of course I have to rewrite it. It's not going to be good the first time. So I ask them to try to think about writing in a little bit different way. I actually got two books that came directly from my experience as a teacher of English as a second language. When I first would meet a new classroom of students, they were often newly arrived in the United States. My class would be one of the first ones they would take, English as a second language, and they were often really nervous. As an icebreaker, I used to ask them about animal noises in their language. So, in English, what does a dog say? Bow wow or arf arf. But dogs all over the world don't say that. And I learned, for example, that in Korea, a dog says mung mung. And when I take it into schools, I'll say, you know, in this country, I'll say, does a dog say mung mung? And these kids will all go, no. And I'll say, well, what about this? Mung mung! Mung mung! In Russia, a dog says gav gav. And I learned that there's these wonderful animal noises all over the world that people make. So I have a book called Mung Mung, which is a guessing game book of animal noises around the world. What I've always said was, my dream is to be a fly on the wall, or maybe dead and floating around wherever dead people go, and to hear a young person or any reader say, "Oh, I've just read this fantastic book. It's about, it's about," and then they go and talk about my book. I think the stories, again, stories in general are much more important than any one person as an individual. And I don't mind if people forget my name, as long as they remember my stories. "Our part of Korea is like a dragon with many humps," Sanghee's father said. "The humps are the mountains, the first hump facing the sea, the last hump facing the king's palace. Our mountain is the first hump. Our fire is the first fire." Every evening at sunset, Sanghee's father climbed to the top of the mountain carrying a pair of tongs and a little brass pot filled with live coals. Coals to start a fire. A fire so big it could be seen from the next mountain, where another firekeeper saw it and lit his fire. A fire big enough to be seen from the next mountain, where a third firekeeper saw it and lit his fire, and on, a fire on every hump of the dragon's back, all the way to the last one, the hump that could be seen from the palace walls. When the king saw the fire on the last mountain, he knew that all was well in the land.
The Reading Rockets Meet the Author series is a production of WETA. Major funding for Reading Rockets comes from the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs. For more author interviews, recommended reading lists, and information about teaching kids to read, please visit us online at www.readingrockets.org.